Hi, good afternoon, everyone. First of all, thank you for taking our time to attend today's webinar. For first-time visitors, T-Fusion series of webinars is a carefully curated list of topics which are very important and fundamental for transfusion medicine practice. And today we are going to cover on the topic guidelines for donor selection, who can and who cannot donate. As you would all agree, this is a very important topic. And before we move further, let me also request all of you to post your queries or comments to the panel towards the end of the session. While during the session is on, you may post your queries, and towards this end of the session, the panel will take up your questions and answer them accordingly. We also will be having an interactive polling session, so please give your inputs to the questions, to the options that are mentioned in the questions, so that we get a general idea about your expertise on the topic discussed. So before we introduce the speaker, let me first introduce our moderator for the session. Our moderator is Dr. Prashant Pandey. Many of you who are have attended previous sessions would already know him, but for new visitors, let me introduce Dr. Pandey. Dr. Pandey is the Additional Director and Head of Transfusion Medicine and Transplant Immunology at the JP Hospital, Noida, where he has been serving for 7 years. Prior to JP Noida, he was at the Medanta Medicity in Gurgaon, where he was a consultant for about 4 years. Prior to that, he served at the Global Hospitals in Bangalore as a consultant and in charge for 2 years. And then prior to that, he was a junior and senior resident in the prestigious SGPGI Lucknow. Dr. Pandey had done his MBBS and MD MBBS from KGMC Lucknow in 2002, and then MD in immunohematology and blood transfusion from SGPGI in Lucknow in 2006. He is very prolific writer, and he has published more than 60 national and international journals, articles in national and international journals, which are indexed. He's a reviewer of journals like Transfusion and Apheresis Science, Journal of Clinical Apheresis, Blood Transfusion, AJTS, Therapeutic Apheresis and Dialysis, etc. He's a Six Sigma Black Belt holder. He is an NABH hospital assessor from Quality Council of India, and he has assessed more than 20 hospitals. He is a recipient of H.D. Shorey Travel Fellowship Award from ISBTI 2010, and ISTM Best Paper Award in 2013 and 15, Best Oral Paper Award from ASFA Texas, USA in 2020. He is a life member of the most important societies nationally and internationally in transfusion medicine and transplant immunology. He is a co-convener of special interest group on therapeutic apheresis from Indian Society of Transfusion Medicine. His areas of interest are immunohematology, therapeutic apheresis, transplant immunology, flow cytometry, and academic research and publication. So really a pleasure and honor to introduce Dr. Prashant Pandey, who is going to take over the session from here on. Over to you, Dr. Pandey.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Arjit. And sorry, actually, because of some internet bad problem, I could not join right from the beginning. So I was 5 minutes late. I think the topic what has been given to me to talk about is about donor selection criteria. And in the arena of donor selection, the present of why we are talking about is the COVID era actually. This selection was one of the most difficult, many donors were coming with the symptoms of cough and cold. So science will give you an idea how the selection criteria for the COVID is presently. It was for the plasma and presently the blood donor selection criteria. So we'll also give that how to select the donor having symptoms of cough, cold, and those who were declared COVID positive and not treated. Dr. Sweta will present the talk. What the topic is, donor selection criteria, and the she will focus on COVID also. So she will give a presentation the whole about how to select the donor, how to deselect or reject the. Actually, everyone is those who are right from the beginning in this seminar series, they must be knowing about Dr. Sweta. But those who are joining for the first, just like to introduce Sweta to that. That Dr. Sweta is doing DNB. In transplant medicine from JP Hospital, Noida. And she has presented various papers in the national and international journals. And in fact, she has not completed DNB, but she has presented more than 15 papers in various international and national journals. And the area of interest, what I know as a faculty of her, she is having interest in therapeutic apheresis. She has interest in immunology. She is having interest in academic public papers. So she is very good in biostat also. So she is really a very good DNB student, and now she is going to appear in the exam. Since she has is having exam from 14th or 15th of next month, but still she could spare some time to prepare the presentation. For this, I would like to send my sincere thanks to Sweta. And with these words, I would request her to please start the talk and share your screen. Thank you to Dr. Sweta.
Thank you, sir. We are going to discuss guidelines for donor selection, who can and who cannot donate blood or platelets. Next one, please. We will be discussing the topic under the contents Drug and Cosmetic Acts 1940 and Drug and Cosmetic Rules 1945 and the amendments, current donor selection criteria and donor deferral and special considerations in the COVID era. Next. As we all know that the key to safe blood transfusion is having safe and healthy donors, and the donor should be voluntary, non-remunerated, low risk, safe and healthy. The encouragement and retention of adequate number of healthy repeat donors is very important for a blood transfusion service, and the donor should be appropriately recognized and thanked for their contribution to the society. Next. Now, something about Drug and Cosmetic Acts and Rules. Human blood is covered under the drug definition of drug under Section 3B of Drug and Cosmetics Act. The Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940 is an act of Parliament of India which regulates the import, manufacture and distribution of drugs in India. The primary objective of the act is to ensure that the drug and cosmetics sold in India are safe, effective and conform to state quality standards. However, the Drug and Cosmetic Rules 1945 are the rules which the Government of India has established through the Drugs and Cosmetic Acts 1940. And these rules classify drugs under given schedules and present the guidelines for the storage, sale, display, and prescription of each schedule. Next. Next slide, please. Now, the amendments in Drug and Cosmetic Acts and Rules. Amendments have been done from time to time to meet the latest standards. The first amendment in context of the blood transfusion services was done in 1989. And in this amendment, the HIV testing for the testing for HIV 1 and 2 antibodies was made mandatory before transfusion. Next. Then in 1992, first amendment was done. And the Drug Controller General of India was vested with the power of Central License Approving Authority. And this amendment related to the collection, storage, processing and distribution of whole blood, blood components by blood bank and licensing of all blood banks was made mandatory. In 1999, the Drug and Cosmetic Rules had second amendment, which related to the inclusion of good manufacturing practices, standard operating procedure and validation of equipment. In 2005, there was sixth amendment in which application for grant or renewal of a license for operation of blood bank or processing of human blood components shall be made by the blood bank run by government, Indian Red Cross Society, hospitals, charitable trusts, or voluntary organizations approved by a state or union territory blood transfusion council only. And in this amendment only, ELISA rapid or RPHA test kits were to be used for hepatitis and HIV 1 and 2 testing. Next. Then in 2017, 8th amendment was done in drugs and cosmetic rules, according to which transfer of whole blood and blood components to another bank with facilities to store and monitor the blood distribution was allowed. Blood donation camps can be organized by a licensed blood bank run by registered voluntary or charitable organization recognized by state or union territory blood transfusion council or a private hospital blood bank. Then the recent amendment was done in 2020, which was the second amendment. And it said that for the word blood bank, the words blood center shall be substituted, and the revised donor selection and referral criteria was given in this rule, this amendment only. Next. As we all know that donor selection and counseling is divided into 5 steps. Pre-donation information, pre-donation counseling, donor questionnaire and health checkup, counseling during blood donation, and post-donation counseling. And in previous presentation by Dr. Divya ma'am, we have discussed the donor selection counseling portion. Now I will be focusing on the third step, that's the donor questionnaire and health checkup in this presentation. Next. Revised guidelines have been approved by the governing body of National Blood Transfusion Council in the 26th meeting held on 1st June 2019. And as we all know that NBTC is the apex policy formulating body for all the matters concerning the operations of blood centers in India. Next. Now we'll discuss about the criteria. First is the general criteria. First is well-being. The prospective donor should be in good health, mentally alert, physically fit. He or she should not be an inmate of jail or any other confinement. And differently abled or donor with communication and sight difficulties can also be accepted, provided they can understand the procedure of the donation process and can give valid consent. Next. The age should be for whole blood 18 to 65 years, and for apheresis it's 18 to 60 years. Maximum age limit has been modified for first time donors, and that is 60 years. For whole blood volume collection and weight of the donor, earlier it was equal to or more than 50 kg, but now it has been changed to more than 45 kg. For 45 to 55 kg, 350 ml of the whole blood will be collected, and for more than 55 kg, 450 ml will be collected. And for apheresis donor, the cutoff weight is 50 kg only. Next. Donation interval. Earlier, the whole blood donation interval for both male and female was 3 months, but now for females, it has been increased to 4 months. And for apheresis, 48 hours interval should be there between two platelet phereses or between a plasma donation and a platelet donation. And it should not be more than 2 times in a week and limited to 24 times in a year. And there has been some changes regarding the interval between platelet phereses and whole blood also, of which platelet phereses after whole blood donation can be done after 28 days. And same is for whole blood to platelet phereses, that is 28 days interval. And during platelet phereses, if reinfusion was not completed, then the interval is 90 days. Any type of donation after a bone marrow harvest, the interval is 12 months. And for any type of donation after a peripheral blood stem cell harvest, it is 6 months. Next. The prospective donor should not be fasting before or not observing a fast during the period of donation and must have taken a meal within 4 hours. There should be no consumption of alcohol and no signs of alcohol intoxication during donation. And the donor should not be a regular heavy alcoholic. For occupation, there are a few checkpoints to be considered. For occupations like air crew member, long distance vehicle drivers, either above sea level or below sea level, or in emergency services, and the places and the occupations where strenuous work is required, there should be 24-hour intervals from the last shift, because it can lead to post-donation syncope. And the person should take adequate sleep of at least 6 to 8 hours before donation. Next. High-risk behavior is also very important criteria to select a donor. The donor should be free from any disease which can be transmissible by blood transfusion, and this can be determined by the history and examination. The person should not be at risk for HIV, hepatitis B, and hepatitis C. Who are the at-risk individuals? These are transgender, homosexual men, female sex workers, injecting drug users, person with multiple partners, and any other high risk as determined by the medical officer deciding fitness to donate blood. Next. And people who have had any symptoms within 6 months related to, which are suggestive of AIDS related complex should be deferred. That includes unexpected weight loss, night sweats, unexplained fever above 99 degree for more than 10 days, swollen lymph nodes for more than 1 month, persistent diarrhea, persistent cough with shortness of breath, purple or blue spots typical of Kaposi's sarcoma, and persistent white patches on unusual blemishes on the mouth. These are suggestive of AIDS related complex. Next. There should be no history of travel or residence to a particular area with endemic disease. The diseases which are transfusion transmissible and for which screening is not mandated, and there is no guidance in India, because in endemic the areas where a disease is endemic, the some person could have antibodies formed against the disease, so they should not be accepted for or accepted at a some time some interval. Donor skin phlebotomy site should be free from any skin disease, skin puncture or scar which are indicative of professional blood donors or addiction of self injected narcotics. Next. Physical examination, the blood pressure, the systolic blood pressure should be 100 to 140 millimeter of Hg, and diastolic blood pressure should be 60 to 90 mf of Hg. It has been also this criteria has also been changed from the previous one. There should be no finding suggestive of end organ damage or secondary complications. There should be no change in the in drug or the dosage of the which the donor was taking, dosage of the drug within 28 days. Pulse rate should be between 60 to 100 beats per minute, and it should be regular. Temperature should not be more than 37 degrees Celsius or 98.4 degrees Fahrenheit. The donor should be free from any acute respiratory disease, and hemoglobin should be equal to or more than 12.5 gram per deciliter. And those with thalassemia trait can be accepted if hemoglobin is acceptable. Next. Minor non-specific symptoms that include but not limited to general malaise, pain and headache. The person should be deferred until all symptoms subside and the donor is afebrile. Next. There is a 12-month deferral period after delivery and 6 months after abortion. Earlier it was only 3 months after abortion. And the breastfeeding, the deferral should be for total period of lactation, and for menstruation, the donor should be deferred for a period of menstruation. The thing is that during pregnancy, there is a considerable amount of considerable loss of iron stores to the body. So the iron store should be allowed to recover, and that takes time. And regarding menstruation, that is not a reason for deferral. If a donor donates during their period, they can be advised to take iron supplementation. But if they are having heavy bleeding, so they cannot be accepted because the iron iron store will be very less, and they should be then referred to a physician. Next. For cold, flu, cough, sore throat, and acute sinusitis, defer until the symptoms subside and donor is afebrile. For chronic sinusitis, can be accepted unless on antibiotics, and the individual on asthmatic attack or on steroids should be permanently deferred, because blood donation will decrease the total oxygen carrying capacity of the blood, and that will increase the difficulty in breathing also. So these asthmatic donors should be deferred. Next. People who had major surgery should be deferred for 12 months after recovery, because there can be hospitalization or use of anesthesia or have blood transfusions or have significant blood loss. So to fully recover from these situations, 12 months is required. For minor surgery also, for the same reason, 6 months after recovery. If they have received any type of blood transfusion, 12 months deferral. If the person has had open heart surgery, including bypass surgery, and cancer surgery, they should be permanently deferred. And for tooth extraction or any dental surgery under anesthetic, the deferral should be for 6 months because dental manipulation can be associated with transient bacteremia. Next. The people with cardiovascular diseases like chest pain, shortness of breath, swelling of feet, myocardial infarction, cardiac medications, hypertensive heart disease, coronary artery disease, angina pectoris, and rheumatic heart disease with residual damage should be permanently deferred because this disease history can affect the donor's ability to tolerate hemodynamic changes due to blood donation. Next. For central nervous system and psychiatric diseases, individuals with migraine can be accepted if the migraine is not severe and occurs at a frequency of less than once a week. And for anxiety and mood disordered donors, individuals, if there is depression or bipolar disorder, but on the day of donation, they are stable and feeling well, regardless of medication, they can be accepted. But those individuals who have convulsions, epilepsy, and schizophrenia should be permanently deferred. Because the donation can temporarily decrease the oxygen supply to the blood that can precipitate convulsions and fainting episodes. And vasovagal syncope, that is the most common adverse reaction associated with donation, it can also precipitate an epileptic seizure. Next. Regarding endocrine disorders, the most important conditions are diabetes and thyroid disorders. A diabetic can donate blood if the blood sugar is well controlled by diet and oral hypoglycemic medications. There is no history of orthostatic hypotension or no evidence of infection, neuropathy, or vascular diseases, in particular peripheral ulceration. If the oral medication has been changed or dose has been changed, there should be a deferral period of 4 weeks for the blood sugar to normalize. And if the patient, donor is on insulin, he should be permanently deferred because there is a risk of hepatitis and other infections transmission due to the unsafe injection practices. For thyroid donors, those with benign thyroid disorders, if they are euthyroid, can be accepted. And if the thyroid status is unknown or they are under an investigation for thyroid disease, they should be deferred. And there should be permanent deferral if there is thyrotoxicosis due to Graves' disease, hyper or hypothyroidism, or history of malignant thyroid tumors. And for other endocrine disorders, there should be permanent deferral. Next. So as I said, diabetic ulcer or amputation wound has the risk of bacteremia. And due to autonomic neuropathy, there can be a risk of postural hypotension, and insulin-dependent individuals are at risk of hepatitis and other infections due to unsafe injection practices. Also, for thyroid diseases, if there is an over or underactive thyroid, there is a risk of heart disease. And the treatment of hyperthyroidism with radioiodine therapy and antithyroid drugs is potentially harmful to the unborn child of the transfused mother. That is, they are teratogenic. Next. For liver diseases and hepatitis infections, if the person is a known case of hepatitis B and hepatitis C, he or she should be permanently deferred. And if the nature of hepatitis is not known, they also should be permanently deferred. And if the hepatitis is A or E, then he or she should be deferred for 12 months. For spouse, partners, close contact, or individuals suffering with hepatitis, or at risk for hepatitis by tattoos, acupuncture, or body piercing, scarification, and other invasive cosmetic procedures by self or spouse or partner, the deferral should be for 12 months. For spouse or partner or individuals receiving transfusion of blood or blood components, deferral period is 12 months. For jaundice, if the jaundice is due to gallstone, RS disease, mononucleosis, or it was in neonatal period, the donor can be accepted. And if the donor is suffering from chronic liver disease or liver failure, they should be permanently deferred. Next. So this is the explanation. Jaundice can be caused due to gallstones or can be associated with infections such as hepatitis. And these infections might be passed on by transfusion. And for needle stick injury, the needle exposure can be associated with HIV or hepatitis B or C infection transmission. So a 12-month deferral period is applied to ensure that these infections, if present, can be detected by testing at the time of donation. Next. for HIV infections and other sexually transmitted infections. If the person is at risk for HIV infection, as I discussed earlier, and known HIV positive person or spouse or partner, PLHA, that is person living with HIV AIDS, should be permanently deferred. If the person has symptoms of AIDS, they should be permanently deferred. And if the person has syphilis or gonorrhea, they should also be deferred permanently, because since these are sexually transmitted infection, they are also at risk for acquiring HIV infection. So these individuals should be permanently deferred. Next. For other infectious diseases, history of measles, mumps, chickenpox, the deferral period is 2 weeks following full recovery. For malaria, it's 3 months. Typhoid, it's 12 months. Dengue or chikungunya, if there is a disease history, the deferral should be for 6 months. And if there is a history of travel to endemic areas, the deferral should be for 4 weeks. And for Zika virus and West Nile virus, if there is a history of Zika virus infection, deferral period is for 4 months. And if there is a history of of travel to West Nile endemic areas or Zika outbreak area, defer for 4 months. So this criteria is given because the body needs to clear the bacteremia, jo protozoa or whatever microorganism should be cleared from the bloodstream, and the person should be fully recovered and should become physically fit to donate blood. So these deferral periods have been defined. Next. For tuberculosis, the deferral period is for 2 years. Earlier, it was 5 years following confirmation of cure. Leishmanian leprosy patient should be permanently deferred. For conjunctivitis, deferral for the period of illness and continuation of local medication. And for osteomyelitis, deferral period is for 2 years following completion of treatment and cure. Next. Regarding the kidney diseases, if there is acute infection of kidney, 6 months deferral after complete recovery. If there is acute infection of bladder or UTI, deferral for 2 weeks after complete recovery and the last dose of medication. And if there is chronic infection of the kidney or chronic kidney disease or chronic renal failure, the person should be permanently deferred. As we all know that the pyelonephritis is the infective condition, so there is high risk of anemia and infection, and renal stones can also be associated with infection. So such people should be deferred until they are completely recovered. Next. Now the digestive system. If a person is having a history of diarrhea in preceding week, particularly if associated with fever, the deferral period is 2 weeks after complete recovery and last dose of medication. Earlier it was 7 days deferral, but now it has increased to 2 weeks of deferral period. For GI endoscopy, deferral period is of 12 months. That is, again, the GI endoscopy can be associated with the risk of transmitting infections. So the deferral period is 12 months. For acid peptic disease, person with acid reflux, mild GI reflux, mild hiatus hernia, gastroesophageal reflux disease and hiatus hernia can be accepted. And if a person has stomach ulcer with symptoms or with recurrent bleeding, he or she should be permanently deferred, because in this case, the ulcers can be associated with decreased iron stores and anemia due to bleeding. Next. Other diseases like autoimmune disorders, which includes SLE, scleroderma, dermatomyositis, ankylosing spondylitis, or severe rheumatoid arthritis, they should be deferred because these people are already not well, not physically fit to donate blood. Polycythemia vera individuals should be permanently deferred because this is a precancerous condition. Those with bleeding disorders and unexplained bleeding tendency should be deferred because they have decreased iron stores. Those with malignancy should be permanently deferred because they are also not physically fit. For severe allergic disorders, there is permanent deferral as a prophylactic measure or due to increased amount of IgE in their blood. And those with hemoglobinopathies and red cell enzyme deficiency with known history of hemolysis should also be permanently deferred. For example, in G6PD deficiency, where the red cells are prone to damage due to oxidative stress. So if a G6PD deficiency suffering person's blood is transfused to another person, and that recipient takes any type of medication which causes hemolysis or it acquires any type of infection, so these transfused red cells will be immediately hemolyzed and the hemoglobin will not increase. So it is so this type of donor should be permanently deferred. Next. Now the vaccination and inoculation. For non-live vaccine and toxoids, earlier there was no deferral period defined, but now it is 14 days. For live attenuated vaccines, the deferral period is for 28 days. Earlier it was 14 days. For anti-tetanus serum, anti-venom venom serum, and anti-diphtheria and anti-gasgarin serum, the deferral period is 28 days. And for anti-rabies vaccination, or hepatitis B immunoglobulin or any type of immunoglobulin, the deferral period is for 1 year. Next. Next is the about medications which are taken by prospective blood donors. If the individual is taking an oral contraceptive, analgesics, vitamins, mild sedatives and tranquilizers, allopurinol or cholesterol lowering medications on the day of donation, they can be accepted. If they have taken aspirin or other NSAIDs, and if platelet has to be prepared, then they should be deferred for 3 days. Next. For ketoconazole, anti-helminthic drugs, including mebendazole, the deferral period is 7 days. For antibiotics, the deferral period is 2 weeks. For ticlopidine, clopidogrel, pyroxicam and dipyridamole, the deferral period is 2 weeks after last dose. For etretinate, acitretin, isotretinoin, and finasteride, the deferral period is 1 month. And these medicines are teratogenic in nature. For radioactive contrast material, the deferral period is 8 weeks because it has to be cleared from the circulation. For dutasteride also, this is also a teratogenic, and the deferral period is 6 months after last dose. If there is any medication which is of unknown nature, the donor should be deferred until the details are available. For insulin, as I have discussed earlier, there is permanent deferral. And for antiarrhythmic, anticonvulsant, anticoagulant, antithyroid, thyrotoxic drugs, and cardiac failure drugs, if the person is taking, then he or she should be permanently deferred because of their disease condition. Next. Other conditions that require permanent deferral are those who are recipients of organ, stem cell, or tissue transplant, donors who have had unexplained delayed faint or delayed faint with injury, or two consecutive faints following a blood donation. These should be permanent deferred. Next. Now the most important part of the presentation about in the COVID era, special considerations in COVID era. The National Blood Transfusion Council had issued first interim national guidance to blood transfusion services in India in light of COVID-19 pandemic on 25th March, and the second interim was issued on the 1st June. According, next. So they gave the criteria for donor selection related to COVID-19 pandemic. They divided the donor into three categories: confirmed case, contact history, and travel history. The confirmed case with lab confirmation of SARS-CoV-2 infection by RT-PCR test, irrespective of sign and symptoms, the deferral period is for 28 days after discharge from the treating facility or 28 days after the end of home isolation. In case of contact history, the deferral period is for 28 days with the last possible close contact exposure to a person who is confirmed or suspected case of COVID-19, including those people who are under quarantine. And for travel history also, deferral period is for 28 days after the date of departure from that country. So the deferral period for COVID-related history is 28 days for all the three categories. Next. Now the selection criteria for COVID convalescent plasma donors. CDSCO India have given the guidelines for eligibility of donors for the donation of CCP. The age should be more than 18 years and it should be male or nulliparous female donors. Multiparous female donors are not eligible. Weight should be more than 55 kg and the prior diagnosis of COVID-19 should be documented by a laboratory test, that is RT-PCR, with symptomatic disease with at least fever and cough. So at least fever and cough should be present. And there should be complete resolution of symptom at least 28 days prior to donation. And if there is complete resolution of symptoms at 14 days prior to donation, then there should be two negative RT-PCR reports required, collected 24 hours apart. And apart from these, the donor eligibility criteria for whole blood donation should also be followed, which is according to Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940 and Rules 1945, which was amended till March 2020. Next. There are some situations of which India, there is no guidelines available in India. Some guidelines have been given by the FDA, that is blood donor deferral following CCP transfusion, and that should be 3 months. So if a person has been transfused with CCP, they should be deferred for 3 months. If an individual who has never been infected with COVID-19 and have received a COVID-19 vaccine, they are also not eligible to donate CCP. If a patient is recovered from COVID-19, they are eligible to donate CCP and also receive an vaccine after recovery, are also eligible to donate. So they should have symptom of COVID-19 and they should have a positive test result from a diagnostic test to donate CCP. Next. For blood donor deferral post COVID-19 vaccination, in India, no guidelines have been developed. Some information have been given on the FDA's webpage, updated information for blood establishments regarding the COVID-19 pandemic and blood donation. So according to that, blood donor deferral following COVID-19 vaccine is not required. But if an individual who has received a non-replicating, inactivated or mRNA-based COVID vaccine can donate without a waiting period. So if they have got a killed vaccine, they can donate blood, there is no deferral period. If they have received a live attenuated vaccine, then they should wait for 14 days after the receipt of vaccine. And if they don't know about the nature of the vaccine, what vaccine was administered, then they should wait for 14 days only. And any decision to update the policies for deferral following COVID vaccines is left to the discretion of the medical director only. Next. In India, two types of vaccines are being given. First is Covishield from AstraZeneca and Serum Institute of India. It is a live attenuated vaccine according to the manufacturer, that is made from a weakened version of a common cold virus known as adenovirus from chimpanzees. So since it is a live vaccine, that makes the deferral period to 28 days. But according to the UK guidelines, it is a non-live vaccine. And in their country, the deferral period for non-live vaccine is 7 days. So this depends on the country. Then the next one is Covaxin, which is manufactured by Bharat Biotech, and it is an inactivated vaccine, and hence the deferral period for this vaccine is 14 days. Next. So these a few slides were about the facts considered for COVID, which I could gather from various resources. Now, some points, some cases where guidelines are given by WHO, but there is no guideline in India regarding biopsy, celiac disease, CJD, Epstein-Barr virus infection, thrombocytopenia, vitiligo. The list is very long, which will take very much time to describe. I have highlighted some important conditions only in for if the needle biopsy has been done and the donor is free from any bacterial infection and he's well, then can be accepted. Malabsorption syndromes. Malabsorption syndrome individuals are deferred permanently, but the exception is celiac disease if it is fully treated. For CJD, there is permanent deferral. For Epstein-Barr virus also, there is 28 days deferral period after full recovery. For thrombocytopenia cases, if the person was suffering from acute autoimmune thrombocytopenia in the past and have recovered and 5 years have been elapsed and he's or she is not on treatment, then they can also donate blood. And those which have vitiligo, they can also be accepted as a prospective blood donor. Thank you.
Very good, Dr. Sita. I think in just 30 minutes, you presented very well the whole aspect of the donor selection criteria and the different amendments what have in these years. So this is the complete guideline about the Drug and Cosmetic Act selection criteria of the donor. And when to defer, when permanently to defer the donor permanently, when to defer the donor for a short period. It is very well, it was very well described. So I think the time has when we get a Zoom poll. So there are some confusion of the participants or if they want to clarify. So I think when they go through the name of the Zoom poll, they would be able to understand what the answers are.
Yes, sir.
So Pune, can we start? And Dr. Shweta?
Yes, sir.
So one by one the answers will come. So this is the first question. The most amendment Drug and Cosmetic Act was in which year? So 40% people have given the answer 2020. Is it correct, Dr. Shweta?
Yes, yes sir. This is the recent amendment. Correct answer.
Correct. And you described in the question also.
Yes, sir. I described.
So most of the answers are correct, but 33% people said 2017 also. So it's now clear. 2020 is the most recent amendment in the Drugs and Cosmetic Act. Next. Which of the following would be the cause of? First one is the temperature of 101 degree Fahrenheit, blood pressure 110/70, pulse rate 80, and none of these. So temperature more than 101 Fahrenheit is the correct answer. So Shweta, this one is the correct answer, no?
Yes, sir. Yes, this is the correct answer.
Correct. So what is the criteria for it? What it should be?
The temperature should not be more than 98.4 degree Fahrenheit or 37 degree centigrade. Because if the correct. Temperature is higher, then it can indicate a mild illness or some infection going on.
What about the pulse and what about the blood pressure?
The blood pressure for systolic, it is between 100 to 140. And for diastolic, it's between 60 to 90. So this option is also correct. For pulse rate, it is 60 to 100. So this option is also correct.
Correct. Next problem. So which of the following would go for permanent deferral? So answer is of the like to have a receipt as a person having anti-amyloid drugs. Recipient of bone transplant. So you described in your presentation. So I think we should go ahead. Purnima, please. Immunization for rubella would result in a temporary deferral for 51% have said 4 weeks. Is it correct, Dr. Shweta?
Yes, sir. Rubella is a live vaccine for which deferral period is 28 days or 4 weeks.
Okay, good. And 1 year for which vaccine?
So it's for the hepatitis B immunoglobulin and other immunoglobulins and anti-rabies vaccine immunoglobulin.
Is there any vaccine where the deferral is 6 months?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So we'll go ahead for the next. So donors for diagnosed type 2 diabetes mellitus can donate blood if the donor is taking insulin. This is the incorrect answer. So 85% people have given answer like blood sugar is controlled by diet and oral hypoglycemic drugs. Correct. And you just described your presentation.
Yes, sir.
So I think we should go. Next, Purnima. Which of the following donors can be accepted? So 62% have given answer. All are eligible to donate blood means donors who had a first trimester MPP 8 months back.
Sir, excuse me. This option is incorrect. The answer will be first one.
Correct. I'm just coming to that. I'm just coming to that. Yes. So first one, because most of 62% people have said all are eligible to donate. This means first one is that donor who had a first trimester MPP 8 months back. This cannot be correct. Reason is that you said that you describe the reason one by one for the first, second and third, please.
Sir, MTP means abortion. So after 6 months, the donor can donate. So they can be accepted. Those who are treated for, yes, sir. And for gonorrhea, there is permanent deferral. For needle stick injury, there is 12 months deferral. So the correct answer will be first one.
Correct. Because gonorrhea is a sexually transmitted disease.
Yes, sir.
And with that, there is a when there is a sexually transmitted disease, then we need to defer our donor for a longer period, means permanent deferral. Is it a permanent deferral for gonorrhea?
Yes, sir. For gonorrhea is permanent deferral.
So permanent deferral for other sexually transmitted diseases are what?
So for syphilis and hepatitis B and C and AIDS.
Correct. So donors who had a needle stick injury 10 months ago, what is the deferral period for this?
So the 12 months is the deferral period.
Correct. Is there any reason why they have taken the 12 months for the blood transfusion, 12 months for the needle stick injury, and 12 months for some other disease also?
So because,
is there any reason for that?
So because of the risk of transmission of infection, that's and why they have taken 12 months.
Sometimes the window period could be longer. We were not able to detect the disease with the serology based investigations, and that's why it has been kept a bit longer. Though it is not, sometimes it is not practical, and that is the reason why it has been kept longer to deal with the window, longer window period and the seroconversion phase. Okay, next. Next, Purnima. As per DC Second Amendment Rules 2020, a female donor can donate whole blood at an interval of 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, or females are not eligible. So 75% they are saying 4 months. Is it okay?
Yes, sir, it's correct.
So why it has been changed? Because some of the audience must be liking to know why it has been changed from the 3 months to 4 months.
So because in female, they are already iron stores are less in comparison to males, and after blood donation, the amount again decreases more. So there is some difficulty in replenishing those iron stores, so because we know that Indian female diet is very not rich in iron, and they don't care about their health also, and they are sometimes they don't want to take medicine also. So that's why it has been increased. In comparison to
so in short, means to give sufficient time to the female donor to replenish the iron stores, correct?
Yes, sir.
Correct. Okay, fine. So next, Purnima. Which of the following is a reason for deferral? First one is a male age 24 years taking tablet azithromycin for sore throat. Is a reason, is it 52% people are saying is the reason for deferral. Second one is a female age 35 years taking OCP. Third one is a male age 56 years on regular antihypertensive with a BP of 130-90. A female aged 50 years on hormone replacement therapy. Which one is the correct answer?
So first one is correct. First one is correct because they're suffering from infection. That's why.
So a male age 24 years taking oral antibiotic for sore throat. Correct?
Yes.
This is the correct answer.
Yes, sir.
Why this is the reason for deferral and why not the HRT?
So there is no criteria given for hormone replacement therapy, and hemoglobin can be, if acceptable, then female can donate.
Okay. But when anyone is taking antibiotic for sore throat, means he is having some infection, might be having fever, the infection could be in the bloodstream. So it may infect the blood collected from the donor. So it may cause septic reaction to the recipient. And that is the reason we want to defer the donor. And that's the reason the donor was deferred. Okay, next, Purnima. Okay, which of the following is true? So first one, we would discuss each option actually, so that the audience understand what is behind that. A dose with ingestion of aspirin last night can platelets. Can you do that?
Sir, as we all know that aspirin is an irreversible inhibitor of cyclooxygenase enzyme. So it inhibits platelet aggregation. That's why if the person has taken aspirin and platelets are to be made, he or she has to wait for 3 days.
Correct. So, and to some extent, it also causes platelet function disorder also.
Yes,
to
sir.
Some dysfunction in the platelet, not disorder. So the platelets might not be effective to the recipient. So that's the reason why. So what is the exact deferral period when the individual is taking aspirin?
It's 3 days.
It's 3 days, 72 hours actually, yes, before accepting the donor as a platelet apheresis donor.
Yes, sir.
A donor with a history of malaria 2 months back is eligible to donate blood, not?
Sir, the deferral period is for 3 months after full recovery.
Okay. So third one is after donating whole blood, a donor has to wait for 3 months to donate platelets. Is it correct?
No, sir. It has been now changed to 28 days. After whole blood donation, platelet can be donated after 28 days.
What it was earlier?
It was 3 months.
It was 3 months after whole blood donation?
After whole blood donation.
Okay. So why it was 3 months earlier and it has been reduced to 28 days?
So maybe due to some loss of red cells, and if the transfusion was not completed, that's why they have given 3 months earlier.
What the equipments were there, the extra corporeal volume was relatively higher, 280 to 350 ml. Now most of the equipments are having the extra corporeal volume of 140, 150 ml. So that's the reason why, and the incidence of the incidence has decreased where the failure of procedure is there. So loss is also not that much. That's why it has been reduced to 28 days. So a donor who came in contact with the confirmed case of COVID-19 2 months back can donate whole blood or platelets. This you have already confirmed during the last 2-3 slides.
Yes, sir.
So correct. Purnima, next one. Okay. What is the deferral period for a donor who was a confirmed case of COVID-19? So 28 days, 80%, 77% guys have said given the correct answer. So this is the correct answer, Shweta?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Correct. This you also presented. So next, Purnima, any else? Okay, great. So it was really a very nice one. Now we'll see the question answers. Someone has asked, I will just read one by one. I will just find the correct question. First one was, please tell us about the COVID vaccine related guidelines. This already you have presented very well, so we will not go. There is one question has been asked, Shweta, what is the difference between the permanent and indefinite deferral? Is there anything written in the Cosmetic Act like indefinite deferral?
So I think both are same.
I think I also, but Dr. Sheikh, if you have any idea about this, I think the permanent and indefinite deferral are same, because I have not seen anything like indefinite deferral in the Drug and Cosmetic Act. So I think both are same. There is one more anonymous attendee that Shweta, you are very fast actually.
So I got anxious. Fast more anxious over there.
Okay, so it was a very nice presentation, Shweta. It's really difficult to present the whole Drug and Cosmetic Act in 30-40 minutes. There is every topic can be discussed separately. So you presented very well, and some of the speakers might be. So now the next one. Ma'am, how many times SBP donation can be done in a year? This is a very common question. So how many times it can be, Dr. Shweta?
So in a year, 24 times a person can donate SDPC.
And how many times in a month?
4 times in a month, 2 times in a week, and 24 times in a year.
Correct. So maximum 4 times in a month and 24 times in a year a donor can donate. And after every week you can give. So what will be the deferral for person taking finasteride but not for BPH? Person going out of India for few years. Finax, if someone is taking Finax for hair fall or some other reason, can't they donate the blood if they are taking any kind of this? This is that I think many of the cosmetic surgeons, they are prescribing their patient for hair fall. So is there any deferral for finasteride?
So for finasteride, there is 1 month deferral has been given by the Drug and Cosmetic Act. and for they have written for BPH because most commonly they're given as an example for BPH.
So in general, if anyone is taking finasteride, even not for the BPH, we should defer at least for a month. Correct?
Yes, sir.
I will also try to find out the correct answer, and I will answer later to Diksha Kumari that what is the correct answer. But I agree with Dr. Shweta, since one example given that stride is used in BPH. So for BPH, if it is not being used for 1 month, for other reasons, I think the referral period should be same. Hyperidism on tablet thyroxine, normal thyroid profile, acceptable? Is it acceptable, Dr. Shweta?
Yes, sir, because if the person is taking thyroxine, then he or she would be in a euthyroid condition, so it can be acceptable. It can be accepted.
It can be accepted. If the euthyroid state is maintained, even if the individual is hypothyroidism after taking the thyroxine, the donor can be accepted. And this is very common in female, even in the male donor. We come across 2-3% of the donor who are either hypothyroidism or they are taking the tablet thyroxine. So anyone is taking tablet thyroxine and maintaining the normal thyroid profile, the individual can donate. So there is one more question. What is the reason behind deferring person with alcohol intake? What is the reason behind that, Dr. Shweta?
If a person has taken alcohol, he or she could not be in the mental state to give informed consent or understand the procedure of donation. And there might be some signs of intoxication or dehydration. So that person should be deferred from donation.
That is written in the book, actually. But what I believe personally, it is written very well in the Drug and Cosmetic Act with the last night. If anyone has taken alcohol, I think he or she cannot give. Correct?
Yes, sir.
But if the individual is not in hangover, it's a routine for them, and he is in the mental state of giving the consent form, I think he can donate. We can be on this topic, but many individuals actually come after taking alcohol before donor. It is the decision of the medical director to assess his mental state, whether he can give consent or not, and he can accept the donor. What I personally feel, I may be wrong. There is one more thing. There is one patient who is treated for syphilis. In that case, what should be the deferral period? If an individual is treated with syphilis.
Yes.
So we have to permanent. Correct?
Yes, a permanent deferral period. Yes, sir.
Correct. Because this is a sexually transmitted disease, you might have treated the syphilis, but we don't know actually, he might be having the hepatitis B or hepatitis C or HIV also. So that is the reason the individual or donor should be deferred permanently. There is one Sam Kumar. What about deferral period for COVID vaccine? This you have very well described. I think we will not entertain this question, but if you want to just throw some light about, then what I could understand with the COVID shield, it is 28 days,
yes,
correct?
Yes, sir. It's a live vaccine.
Vax.
Yes, sir.
Correct. And the Pfizer, all their mRNA based vaccines. So I think we need to defer the donor.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
You correct me if I'm wrong.
Sir, as we know that two vaccines are only given in India right now, Covishield and Covaxin. Covishield is a live vaccine, so deferral period should be 28 days. And Covaxin is a killed vaccine, so deferral period should be 14 days.
14 days. But if anyone is coming with the Pfizer, because Pfizer has also applied for the license. For the license, actually.
Yes, sir.
So it is a mRNA-based based vaccine, I think, Pfizer one.
So mRNA.
So, And FDA doesn't say anything about the deferral. They say the donor should not defer. What I understood from your presentation. The RNA-based vaccine, if anyone is taking that vaccine, the donor should not be deferred. Correct?
Yes, sir. But in India, there is a minimum period has been defined 14 days. There is no such thing like no deferral period in India right now. So at least 14 days deferral should be there.
Okay. Do we defer donor for every kind of dental procedure or only for tooth extraction?
So any type of dental procedure which involves anesthesia or use of antibiotics or slight blood loss, they should be deferred for 6 months because there is risk of bacteria.
Okay, correct. This is absolutely correct answer. Now there is one more question. I think it would be for Dr. Arjit. Previous webinar videos available. Is it available, Dr. Arjit?
Yes, all recordings are available, so they can be sent on request. So whenever we receive an email request for a specific video, we can share those videos with the requester.
Very, very good. Okay, then it means it is available. If it is required, it can be asked. What the question? What is the meaning of null carous female? So it's a very simple MBBS like question, but yes, please, if our audience is asking, what is nulliparous female?
A female who has never been pregnant is a nulliparous female.
Correct, absolutely. Now, Dr. Aditi Srivastava, she is asking, how many times granulocyte donation can be done in a year?
I think it's the same as STPC.
It is same, no. I think it won't be like STPC because in granulocyte collection there is loss of red cell.
Red cells loss. It's not like
platelet ferocious. Definitely, Dr. Aditi, we will just come across. I will just check this one and get back to you, Dr. Aditi. So there is one more question during donor selection. Why JL criteria will be considered or mentioned? Please explain.
Sir, the JL inmates can be maybe they are not donating voluntarily, by force they are donating, or due to lack of hygiene and due to high risk behavior also. So these are risk factors, so they are not selected.
That is the reason why we do that. So, Dr. Divya. Oh, sorry. I think Divya is not. I'm using her phone actually. My network was not up. Answer of the granulocyte donation. I'm just thinking. I'll just check Dr. Aditi and get back to you. Harshit Mishra. Can I use polycythemic donor blood for transfusion? Polycythemia, there are conditions like the therapeutic phlebotomy we do. So there is Mr. Harshit, he is asking, can we accept the polycythemic blood for blood transfusion after the therapeutic phlebotomy?
Sir, a polycythemia vera is a precancerous condition. So there is clonal so it is a type of clonal proliferation of the blood cells. So these people's blood should not be used for transfusion.
And actually, what happens? Why don't we ethemic? Because the first line in blood bank is about the ethics. So, and in that, it is very clearly written in the Drug and Cosmetic Act that we have to select the blood from the person who is physically and mentally and socially well. Healthy actually. So polycythemic donor, he's actually not a donor, he's a patient actually, who has come for therapeutic phlebotomy, means blood letting. So when you collect blood for letting, we cannot use for the transfusion. The scientific reason she has explained very well. How do we know that donor is an euthyroid on clinical examination? Dr. Aditi Shweta.
Yes, sir.
Is clinical exam.
Sir, clinically we can't examine the euthyroid state. We can only during the donor questionnaire part we ask about the drug history, and when they tell about the intake of drug for hypothyroidism, then we assume that she is in euthyroid condition.
Aditi, actually being a medical director, by experience you learn for clinical examination of the individual. BP should be normal, pulse should be, it should be more than 60. So these are the common criteria for all the donors. Like we can have the recent investigation if the individual is having, if the individual consulted any doctor and she is taking anti-thyroid medication, then the individual, we can consider that euthyroid state is there. We need not to ask the most recent report. If the individual is having 6 month old report and the TSH dose is there, like 50 microgram, 75 microgram or 25, whatever she is taking. So we should accept the donor considering the phase is euthyroid. We require to follow GVSD for platelet ferresis procedure also or not? Do we require to follow GVSD for platelet ferresis procedure also or not? I think this individual is asking about the selection of the donor. Shall we accept the direct donor or not? The family relatives or not? The first degree family relative we should accept for the platelet ferresis or not? Dr. Peta.
So if any other non-related donor is not available and the only donor available is the first degree relative, then the platelet can be, after harvest, can be irradiated in order to avoid the risk of GVHD.
Correct. Absolutely. What the GVHD, this is the TA-GVHD. To prevent the TA-GVHD, yes, you can have two kinds of protocol. Either you irradiate all the platelets received from the first degree relatives and then transfuse to the patient, or you don't accept the first degree relative. I think the first approach, collect the platelets from the donor and irradiate, because the HLA, they contain HLA-1 antigens on their surface. They can lead to GVHD, TSD. The next one, what is exact period of deferral for smoking? Dr. Shweta.
There is no deferral period for smoking.
Smoking, I think there is no deferral period for smoking, but after blood donation, we ask them to abstain for 2 hours, 6 hours. Up to 2 hours, the donor, he or she should avoid smoking because they need to vasodilation and syncopal attack. And that is the reason why we ask not to smoke after the blood donation. Now, the next question by Dr. Pankaj asks, why thalassemia treatment are not Dr. Pankaj is asking why thalassemia treated people are not Dr. Shweta.
So thalassemia treated people are not dependent on transfusion, and if their hemoglobin is within the normal limit, the cutoff criteria is 12.5 gram per deciliter. So they can be accepted if they have adequate amount of hemoglobin.
Very, very correct. Very correct. So usually thalassemic individuals trait, they have hemoglobin more than 12.5. So they can donate if he or she has not taken any kind of blood transfusion. So that the individual can be accepted as a donor. The DNC Act, the foreigners should be. Diksha Kumari, she is asking that, sir, in the DNC Act, it is written that foreigners should be deferred for 3 years, but what about an Indian who went to a different country for 1 year? Is there any guideline that the foreigners should be deferred for 3 years?
So I have not read it anywhere.
I have not gone through, like, for what reason it has been deferred for 3 years. But what about an Indian who went to a different country for 1 year? I'm not aware, actually, for what reason the individual is deferred for 3 years. You have, Diksha, you have our mail ID. With Dr. Arijit, if you have, I will just find out, just share your mail ID. If I will find out the correct answer of your question, I will just mail to you with the reference. Thank you, Diksha. Now, Shruti is asking, can you please repeat granulocyte donation in a year? This I am sure, Shruti, we can repeat, but exact number, how many times the individual can give in a year, presently, I am not able to recall. So, for correct answer, I will just come back to you. You please share your mail ID to Dr. Rajit and his team, and I will get back to you. Now the last, but not the, what is the difference between bone marrow harvest and stem cell harvest? This is the technical question, actually. So what is the difference between bone marrow harvest and stem cell harvest? This one is the last question.
So bone marrow harvest, so bone marrow is collected from bones, and for stem cell harvest, stem cells are collected from peripheral blood with a apheresis procedure. And bone marrow harvest is done with a needle.
Bone marrow harvest is done from the bone marrow, from the posterior superior iliac spine, or from the sternum, because these are the places where the bone marrow is hypercellular. A cellularity is normal, actually, what we can say. So these are the two places from the posterior superior iliac spine or from the sternum we collect, and this one is called bone marrow harvest. Usually we do in thalassemic babies for doing the transplants, and we get a lot of stem cells. Now the peripheral blood stem cell harvest is done through the technique which is called which is done through the apheresis equipment. So these are the two methods for doing the. Now the third method is also the umbilical cord. So there are three different methods of collecting the bone marrow, actually. First one is the bone marrow harvest, then the peripheral blood stem cell harvest, and third one is from the cord blood. So these were all 27 questions. I think the audience must be happy with the answer what we gave. But if you have any doubt, you can share your mail ID with questions, and you can get my mail ID also. And you can question me, and I will answer you with proper references. So these are the 27, 28 questions and 10 questions we discussed in the Zoom poll. So very good. It was a very nice session, actually. But one more question has come up, actually. Just wait. Donation criteria for a person with history of self-inflicted harm. These are the new, actually. Donations criteria for a person with history of self-inflicted harm.
Sir, self-inflicted harm, it can depend upon the mental condition of the donor. If the donor is right now in a stable condition and can give consent to donate blood, then he can be accepted.
But if he's having, he or she is having that kind of recent, some kind of harm, I think definitely. It depends. Donors current medical doctor, please write his mail ID and I will answer any questions.
Sure.
Correct. There is one Dr. Aditi Srivastava. She has given her mail ID, that aditisonal@gmail.com. So she has asked 2-3 questions. So I think one question that was the most important about the granulocyte harvest. I will come back to you, Dr. Aditi. Thank you, Dr. Aditi and all. So now I think we should end the session with the vote of thanks. And I think I will hand over mic to Dr. Arijit for giving the vote of thanks to all the participants.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. Thank you again for another a wonderful session. Very comprehensive, very informative. Thank you, Dr. Shweta, for covering this topic, very vast topic, in a capsule mode. And thank you, Dr. Prashant, for driving the session, you know, discussing all the questions from the poll and from the audience so very patiently. Thank you, audience, for being such a great participant here while you were interacting with the panel with your questions, which of course has practical implications. And this is the purpose of the entire transfusion webinar series, is that the topics that have been curated are very fundamental. They are very important in terms of the practice, transfusion practice itself. So thank you once again to all of you for having taken out time and logging into this session. We are very pretty sure that you would have benefited in some way from the session itself or from the discussions. May I request Purnima to again flash the email ID wherein people can specifically drop in their queries post-session or maybe request for a copy of the PowerPoint presentation or the video of the session. So here you go. So please use this email address to request whatever you need out of this session and the previous sessions as well. So without any further ado, let me again thank the entire TFusion team, the speakers, moderators, panel, and all the participants who either would have been visiting us for the first time or maybe visiting us for repeated occasions. May I thank you from the, so that, you know, we continue to bring to you more interesting topics. The next one, which is in line on the 5th of March, is on blood bags. And we cover the historical part from then to now. And the topic will be covered by Dr. Divya Sethia, who is also a great speaker. So really excited and look forward to hosting another very important session on blood bags from then to now on 5th of March. So let me welcome you for that session also. Let me invite you for that session also. And our teams, our colleagues will get in touch with you a few days before the session starts. So with that, let me again thank and wind up the session.